It's a pleasure to welcome Dr. Mark Smith, who is a Carolina Distinguished Professor of History at the University of South Carolina, and who's working in a whole other field than we have heard about so far. So we're really getting around in history here, and that is sensory history. And specifically, he's going to talk about the history of natural disasters and in the 19th century. So this particular tsunami in 1867 in the Virgin Islands. So welcome.
Thank you. I'm just going to say a few wholly inadequate thanks to our fabulous hosts, Anna and Betsy in particular, for their kindness and gracious hospitality, and especially to Nicholas, who's been a paragon of efficiency and accommodation, and I do appreciate that. I also appreciate my fellow presenters, from whom I've learned a great deal and from whom I've gained some friendship. So it's been a very pleasant shared experience, I suppose. The year 1867 was momentous for residents of the Danish West Indies. Nasty bouts with cholera and yellow fever in the spring were followed by a devastating hurricane on October the 29th, one that did enormous damage to the entire region, Puerto Rico, St. John, and St. Thomas especially. St. Croix escaped with relatively minor damage, but the overall toll was significant. 500 dead, homes and businesses leveled, more than 60 ships damaged or sunk. Just 20 days later, the islands were hit again, this time by something far more unusual than a hurricane. On November the 18th, at 2:50 p.m., as Danish and American diplomats huddled in Christiansted to discuss the impending purchase of the Virgin Islands by the United States, the first of roughly 89 earthquakes jolted the entire region, generating giant waves or tsunamis. Originating roughly 12 miles south of St. Thomas, two massive back-to-back earthquakes produced two tsunamis 10 to 15 minutes apart. The second was the larger, but both waves propagated in all directions. The tsunamis affected a good deal of the Caribbean, with waves reported as far south as Grenada. Areas hardest hit, though, were St. Thomas, St. Croix, parts of Puerto Rico, and St. John. The waves were enormous. The first tsunami, for example, was variously described as being between 30 and 60 feet high and flowing as fast as 50 miles an hour. It could be seen forming about 3 miles out to sea and spanned the entire island length of St. Thomas. Destruction and death were significant. Dozens of ships were destroyed or severely damaged. At least 23 people died in St. Thomas and St. Croix. The total toll was likely significantly higher, with perhaps as many as 50 lives lost. Homes and businesses were simply washed away. The water rushed inland, some places up to 3,000 yards and as high as 16 feet deep. Earthquakes continued for weeks, although none of them generated tsunamis. While Virgin Island residents had a great deal of experience with hurricanes, tsunamis were very rare, and the extent of the earthquakes was unprecedented. Inhabitants experienced the most awful series of earthquakes ever known in this or any part of the world, so far as the number and duration went, so reported the New York Tribune in 1868. Now, these facts that I've just read to you, as powerful as they are, grant us only limited access to what it was like to experience the natural disasters of 1867. How did people at the time experience such rare and devastating events? How do they process the natural disasters psychologically, emotionally, and physically? What meaning did they attach to surviving these events? Now, one methodology or a technique of historical inquiry, sensory history, allows us to begin to understand the experience and its meaning. So this is a brief summary of what sensory history does. Sensory history stresses the role of all of the senses in shaping people's experiences in the past, and it shows how they understood their worlds and why. It stresses the importance of historical context and gives us a deeper appreciation of the texture, meaning, and human experience of the past. There's a lot more that I could say about this methodology, but I think I'll leave it there for the moment. Context matters a great deal. The senses are not transcendent. They're not ahistorical. The meaning of a sense can only be understood in the context in which it's produced and experienced. So, for example, tornadoes cannot sound like freight trains until freight trains are invented. They're going to sound like something else in a pre-freight train age. And that's important to remember, because the way that people use the senses and metaphors to describe their experience is rooted in context. It's important to understand that these natural disasters of 1867 took place in a moment in Western history where the senses were believed to be the hallmark of modern civilization. So in 1852, for example, we have in Harper's New Monthly magazine a description of the senses as our perpetual bodyguards, attributes to be cultivated and protected. The eye should not be injured by resting on a vulgar confusion of colors or clumsy ill-proportioned forms. The ear should not be falsified by discordant sounds and harsh, unloving voices. The nose should not be a receptacle for impure odors. Each sense should be preserved in its purity. This, of course, is the ideal type. Modern peoples, it was believed, had successfully calibrated and controlled the sensory environment. Sights had been rendered linear, stable, and eyes were a source of truth. Offensive smells had been controlled, courtesy of emerging sewer systems which shuttled urban stench underground, and an increasing attention to personal hygiene. Anti-noise campaigns had gone a long way to controlling sound in urban environments. Protocols regarding tactility, who could be touched and how, and the importance of protecting the skin were becoming ever more firmly in place. And ideas about taste were emerging as fine-tuned, so that gustation, what you ate, was braided with the idea of a refined aesthetic taste. So in this way, the senses served as sentinels of modern civilization. Protecting the senses, then, was important. They should not be abused, lest their function of generating knowledge and information be impaired. Now, foundational to the idea that sensory hierarchies were stable. Not all senses were created equal, and one sense was more deserving of veneration than the others. That was the sense of sight. And this still exists today, of course, because if I say to you, seeing is believing. Seeing is the sense of truth. This is an Enlightenment conceit. Okay, it's not always been the source of truth. Hearing used to be the source of truth in the medieval period. In fact, the full iteration of the phrase seeing is believing was much longer in the medieval period. Seeing is believing, but feeling's the truth, i.e. that touching was the only way to get to the truth, the core of something. So this hierarchy here is really a 19th century hierarchy. It does not really apply with any great precision to earlier periods in history, but we've inherited it. So this hierarchy is supposed to be stable. And the Enlightenment places sight at the top of the sensory hierarchy. The other more proximate senses, especially of smell, taste, and touch, are considered to be less reliable couriers of information. My point here is that the natural disasters of 1867 in the Danish West Indies challenged this view of a stable, ranked sensorium, in that the events were so unusual, so vast in scale, and so unprecedented that people who experienced them had quite literally difficulty making sense of them. Their senses were rendered raw, exposed, unprotected. The lower senses, sound, taste, touch, smell, were elevated in the context of the disasters because sight alone was simply unable to make sense of what was going on. Let me talk first of all about the hurricane. Now, to be sure, the devastation of October's hurricane was easily seen. The stunningly picturesque harbour in St. Thomas was left misshapen and grotesque. In place of strong, regular, upstanding, tidy ship masts, for example, the harbour was left a horizontal mess, the sky tattooed with jagged, sharded, broken masts at irregular angles, piercing, unnatural, and horrendous in their angular forms. Witnesses describe the harbour as strewn with wrecks, the familiar vertical form of the lighthouse now gone. Mighty ships, ships of the line, waterborne ambassadors of powerful nations from Britain, Spain and France, were pummeled into a confused mass, their frames disfigured, crushed hulls, broken spears, loose cordage left indifferently in the middle of the harbour. Large ships were now barely visible, their presence betrayed only by jutting funnels randomly littered throughout the bay. Just outside the harbour was a sad cluster of five large steamers, so crushed together that to distinguish the masts and funnels proper to each was impossible. Impossibly heavy objects, a 9-ton diving bell in St. Thomas, was lifted and thrown a quarter of a mile inland by the surge of the hurricane. A heavy gun used for signalling the time on the fort was incongruously forced through the parapet wall. Indeed, time itself was rearranged by the hurricane. Auditory signals were fewer, bells and signal guns dislodged as they were. Darkness looked different too. The ability to brighten the nights was compromised because the hurricane destroyed the gasworks in St. Thomas. More feeble kerosene lamps had to do the job for several months. The modern ability to light the night, one coveted in the Western world in the 19th century, was severely compromised. Eyes were becoming strained. If the hurricane rearranged the sights, it also impacted the skin, principally in forms of new levels of dampness and wetness. Dry clothing was at a premium, and bodies were chilled to the bone. The hurricane also disrupted the food supply. Crops were destroyed. Scarcity prevailed for weeks. Habits of eating were accordingly suspended. More than that, the sensors in this pre-radio age had failed to adequately detect the coming of the hurricane. As one resident wrote to the editor of the St. Croix Avis a week after the hurricane had hit, everyone as usual got up at the customary hour to attend to their daily business. The morning, with the exception of a little rain, was very beautiful, and with all the appearance of being a fine day. But how we were deceived. The hurricane barreled in just after noon, islanders seemingly oblivious. Contemporaries naturally compared the hurricane and tsunami, agreeing that the latter was 10 times worse, not least because the tsunami was so tightly tethered to the earthquakes and because the tsunamis themselves were almost unheard of events. The tsunami, by which I mean the earthquakes and waves because the two were so tightly braided, destabilized people's senses in unprecedented ways, rendering sight a less reliable sentinel than sound, and elevating the so-called lower senses of smell and touch and taste and hearing to experiential platforms usually reserved for the cool, calculating eye alone. Like the hurricane, the earthquakes and subsequent tsunamis occurred wholly unexpectedly. People's senses were blindsided. One man noted how he was down in the creek with some people cutting wood to make a lime kiln, and was returning home when the first earthquake hit. It was hearing, not seeing, that provided the most alert sentinel. For people on land, the beginning of the tsunami was the sound of the earthquake, a tremendous report as if a heavy cannon had been fired off some distance. The initial boom was followed by a loud rumbling noise, like a number of iron carriages drawn over a rough road by hundreds of wild horses. Cannon. Iron. These were the materials that suggested the gravity, the denseness of the sounds, the subterranean might of the earthquake. This was nature's wrath marrying man's might to create a sound unlike anything heard before. The auditory quickly also became visual, but tactile too. I've never seen or felt anything so dreadful in my life, recalled one survivor. The vibrations penetrated the body and people feared that the land would sink under me. Rumbling was the most common way to describe the beginning of the disaster, an auditory metaphor which captured something of the tactile feel of earth shifting. This underground rumbling noise, a grumbling, itself dreadful, cued the quake. It was so powerful that earth became sea. As Otto Friedrich Raupach of St. Thomas said, the earth seemed as if composed of small waves, making it impossible to walk. The sounds and movements of the earth addled the senses. While those in the water and near the sea ran for the hills, people already in the hills scuttled down them, instinctually headed away from land that might slip. Until, that is, those running down heard a great noise. The earthquake was heard before its effects were seen, but its meaning was not entirely clear until those at the shore and those running downhill looked out to sea. The noise we heard was from the power of the water running back out to the Atlantic. The strange sound gave way to an even stranger sight, something rarely seen, something that was beyond even the most powerful tides to reveal. The seabed of a harbor inhabitants had floated on for generations but never seen. The sea continued to run off until the rocks and reef were all dry, and it seemed to suck away the water out of the bay and leave everything exposed. Even when the tsunami itself was seen, the sight was confusing, courtesy of a dimming of the sun, as if eclipsed, a degradation of vision that lasted until sunset. Squinting, unbelieving eyes nevertheless saw the wave, which stood up like a straight white wall, about from 15 to 20 feet high, according to one witness. It was the sheer size and odd straightness of the wave that caught the eye, like a white masonry wall, erect and straight as if built with the aid of a rule. It had not the appearance of an ordinary wave. Eyes strained to make sense of the incongruous sight. In an effort to convey the sheer scale and ferocity of this event, contemporaries turned to the fate of the USS Monongahela, the massive warship harbored in St. Croix at Frederickstadt when the tsunami hit. The warship, which had seen active service during the American Civil War, was quite enormous. 1,400 tons burden, 361 feet long, drawing from 16 to 20 feet of water. Powered by sail and steam, it was an impressive sight. The tsunami treated the warship, an icon of American might, with utter contempt. The first wave lifted the ship high, seemingly on a level with the tops of the houses. Stunningly, the huge ship was then deposited onto Bay Street, but not for long. Like a child's toy, the warship was dragged violently, almost indifferently, by the receding waters and deposited with architectural precision on a ledge of reef on the shore's edge, high enough that sailors on deck could touch the leaves of trees. The ship was not refloated until May the 11th, 1868, following a four-month effort, and even then it had to be towed to New York City to undergo further lengthy repairs. That's the Monongahela after, in a lithograph, and this is the only photograph we have of it after. Doesn't really convey the extent of the devastation, but it gives you some sense. The multisensory quality of earthquake plus tsunami strained the sensorium, stretching the senses in new ways, rendering them unreliable, plucking them like overly taut guitar strings. The senses could not deal with the unpredictability and the unfathomability of the events. That first night after the giant waves, sleep proved elusive, and not one eye was closed, because of the seemingly endless rumblings, the earthquake after earthquake. Eyes could not close, ears strained in the darkness for the next clue. Bodies fingered the ground, trying to feel the next shock. That first truly awful night would never be forgotten. 200 or so shocks jangled the nerves. Daylight came, and never was it more welcomed by miserable creatures. We were completely worn out. Experiencing the earthquakes and giant waves on land was different from the experience at sea. Certainly the power of the quakes was similar to people in both locations. When the earthquake occurred, it was felt quite as strongly in the ship as ashore, wrote one witness aboard the British steamship La Plata, lying 3 miles from St. Thomas when the tidal wave hit. Visually, though, the perspective of the incoming waves was even more overwhelming from the vantage point of those on ships in the harbors. At sea, the tsunami was simply a sea wall, one so broad that it stretched the whole width of the horizon. The eye was not up to the task of reading the scale of this wave. Comparisons were so few. It was reducible only to the mighty rushing Niagara, but it stretched as far as the eye could see to the north and to the south. It constituted, in other words, a new horizon. The experience at sea sounded different too. Rumblings there were certainly, but aboard ship was offered a different auditory experience. On board the USS Susquehanna in the harbor of St. Thomas, the earthquake was a sound resembling the grinding of a vessel upon a rough bottom. For those on the La Plata, the wave was like a roar of thunder, teasing from the ship a groaning sound as the wave lifted it up. The wave itself generated sounds novel to sailors used to gliding through the sea and not touching its bed. Anchors were pulled taut as ships were dragged, elevated, and plunged. A grating noise was the grim score of such ferocious jostling. The earthquake made timbers quiver, the vibrations turning into audible sound, a buzzing noise somewhat like that of a draft of a smelting furnace or the hum of innumerable swarms of bees. Witnesses struggled to place the metaphor. Only experience helped locate the real cause. "It's an earthquake," offered one sailor, a man who had experienced one before. The fragility of even these very modern ships was laid bare by the waves. Pumps strained mightily as they were caught up in the whirlpools eddying from the waves, leaving big ships spinning like twigs in a stream. Sounds transcended location, tethering land to sea. As the waves engulfed the harbors and streets, residents ran for high ground, their cries for mercy punctuating the hillsides. Animals, usually quiet, bellowed and neighed fearfully. The sounds of whites and blacks collected in groups, praying, crying, a scene never to be forgotten, created new soundscapes. In place of singing in churches that were no longer habitable, religious expression was now open air, spilling from the hillsides. The full sensory impact of the disasters is told not only in the immediacy of the events, but in its legacies. The combined effects of earthquakes and tsunami lasted days, even weeks, principally because the rumbling earth refused to stop. The tenacity of the quakes impacted the sensorium long after the waters had receded. As late as 1873, wrecks could still be seen on the shore and small houses had been built from their bulkheads. Ships were seen high and dry a quarter of a mile away from the water. In gruesome fashion, waterlogged dead bodies kept popping up in the harbour every day or so. "Everything looks changed," wrote one inhabitant. "Some bays are clean gone." Once upright homes were reduced to horizontal foundation stones. Timbers were no longer on land, but at sea. Trees were in wrong places. Food seems to have been available, but not plentiful. Some residents had their palates altered temporarily and had to feed on what amounted to a wartime diet. Because the initial earthquake hit before dinner time, residents started off the experience of disaster hungry. For over 2 weeks, some residents had a monotonous diet of Johnny cake and coffee in the morning, the same in the evening with soup. Taste was rearranged in other ways, especially with regard to place. "Ever since the earthquakes, the water from all the wells here in town and elsewhere is salt," reported the St. Croix Avis in 10th of December, elaborating, "Wells in the east end of the island that were formerly giving no water are now springing abundantly." Like other natural disasters, the earthquakes and tsunamis rearrange palates, diets, and taste patterns, albeit temporarily. The disasters also altered how and where people lived. Stone buildings, many of which were destroyed by the earthquakes, were now deemed unsafe. Initially, people set up makeshift tents and then, during the rebuilding process, opted to build wood homes, which seemed to weather the earthquakes better. This shift undoubtedly affected the sensory world of day-to-day living. In the initial instance, the tents left inhabitants more exposed, their skin and tactile experience and engagement with the world more immediate and less comfortable. Canvas tents replaced comfortable stone rooms. Wind, dust, rain, the growing cold in December, the environment generally played on the body in ways that were new and different. Tent living and the constant threat of earthquakes and the attendant need to be able to run at a moment's notice had the effect of making people cling to their clothes quite literally. One man noted, "For 8 days I have not had my clothes off." He was not alone. Men in Fredrikstad reportedly lost their clothes in the tsunami and had to make do quite literally with the shirts on their back for quite a while. Washing habits, skin care, the rub of damp clothes against skin, all were affected by this disaster. Neither was the sense of smell spared. There were overwhelming new smells produced by rotting bodies and sodden food and cargo, or odors contained in the very harbor water that, in scratch-and-sniff fashion, was released when disturbed. But oh, the stench which prevails when the water is disrupted by an oar or paddle steam, it's positively awful, wrote one observer. Another thought it gets worse every day. There were few solutions. Passengers on board steamers rush from the decks as a vessel moves from alongside, and nobody seems to know how to remove the evil stench. Not even the most powerful disinfecting chemicals of the time stood a chance against the olfactory echoes of the tsunami. This was the stench of decay, one closely associated with disease, miasma, and death, in an era that prided itself on containing and managing and indeed disinfecting such medieval odor. Even more disconcerting odors emerged. Days after the waves, an unusually severe vibration occurred, after which the smell of sulfur was plainly perceptible. At once, the smell was understood as a symptom of danger. A plutonic odor was generated by massive movement in the earth. And in fact, even today in California, people are warned that if they smell something sulfurous, they are about to experience an earthquake. The earthquake and tsunami inspired people on the islands to rethink laws, ponder the nature of their security, and mediate on their vulnerability as modern people. The St. Thomas newspaper, in its call for the repeal of an 1832 law prohibiting the construction of wooden buildings on the islands, made its case by questioning their easy notion of modern mastery. They wrote, "Fire is an element man can contend against. Modern inventions make it possible for him to subdue it. And while he struggles, he is not apprehensive of his life, except on the ocean." But there were no modern inventions capable of taming earthquakes or tsunamis. They rendered man paralyzed and helpless, without assurances whatsoever. "We, the people of the earth," mused the St. Croix Avis in November, "cannot expect to remain here forever." It was the quick succession of earthquakes and giant waves, especially, that strained people's senses. As Louis van Houser, who was aboard the Monongahela at the time of the disasters, mused some years later, "There is nothing, I believe, so trying to a healthy nervous system as a succession of earthquakes. To a landsman, a gale at sea has untold terrors. Yet the tossings of his bark can be accounted for. The wind and waves are there, and the result may be anticipated. But in an earthquake, all these factors are wanting. The cause is mysterious and unknown. The result anticipated is destruction in some form, and the tension of the nerves is most wearing. Imagination magnifies the danger, and thus keeps the sensorium on a constant strain." Or I'll put it another way. The disasters in that terrible winter of 1867 were a sobering and powerful reminder of man's fragility in a world he had increasingly thought he had mastered. Thank you very much. Such a positive note to end on, don't you think?
Thank you very much. So, questions, comments? Yes?
I just want to say thank you for that. Because of that, that took place, there's great oral history on that. And it has been handed down to me, and from me to Nadine, Nadine to her granddaughter. My granddaughter.
All granddaughter.
Yes. Because of that, many lives have been saved in the hurricanes that have taken place. And It can be very colorful at times, so I'm glad that you started on this.
Well, thank you. One of the oddities of this, and having given this paper in the Virgin Islands, it was extremely helpful for me to see the landscape and the place where these things happened, and then to talk to people whose great-grandparents remembered them. Senator Maren Jackson and I had a nice chat about this, precisely. What's different now, of course, is that you have the technology of warning, that your senses are no longer so dependent. So when a hurricane comes through, you get a sense that it's going to come through, you get a warning. There is a tsunami warning system, right? You see it around. However, I did note with interest that the tsunami warning system might not be as effective as people want it to be. Because I was looking at people on the beach, and all of them had their earbuds in. All of them were utterly oblivious to their environment. And the best indicator for a tsunami are birds. You need to be aware of your environment. You'll feel it, perhaps, if it's an earthquake. But you remember those awful and shocking pictures that we saw from the Indian Ocean tsunami? And do you remember what those people did when the water ran out to the ocean? They ran with it. And then they ran back because they didn't know. So I agree with you entirely. There is a store of knowledge that needs to be disseminated, and we shouldn't just rely on technology alone. There's a kind of sensitivity to your environment and your senses that might save your life someday.
Any other questions? Comments? I was kind of intrigued by the what you talked about when you said, you know, how taste was transformed, because after a disaster like this, you don't have access to the food that you normally have. And I was thinking, so is there a long-term consequence? How can you know if a thing like this actually still sort of spills into where we are today? Or have you worked on that or thought about that?
So this question of how long the echo is quite an important question. And I came to this project, I'm really a charlatan here. Okay. Every speaker you've heard today knows much more than I'll ever know about the history of the Danish West Indies. I'm an historian principally of the 19th and 20th century South. But I came to this through my interest in natural disasters. So several years ago, I wrote a book on Hurricane Camille, which is still the most powerful hurricane ever to hit the United States, 1969. And it was a Category 5, and it hit in southern Mississippi. And I wrote a sensory history of the impact of Camille. The duration of the sensory effect depends on the senses and the context in which it hits. So in 1969, you had no FEMA, but you had federal relief. So they could ferry food in. But there's a temporary moment for several weeks where your eating patterns and your taste patterns are disrupted. But it's not one of the permanents. But some things last longer than others. Splinters, cuts, markings on your skin of the event. Most damage is done by debris to the body. And people for many years afterwards have the scars to prove that they were in a natural disaster. There are also all sorts of social rearrangements and suspensions of ordinary rules. So when Camille hits southern Mississippi in 1969, still the most segregated place in the United States, arguably, you have a suspension of rules in which black men are now touching white women to save them from being dragged out. There's also, and they're not being lynched for it, right? They're not being punished for it, because there's a kind of leveling effect in the context of a hurricane so vast. Where the discrimination occurs is not in that moment. Everybody's treated the same. There's a kind of general contempt for humanity. Where the discrimination occurs is in the recovery rates. Who gets to recover first? Who gets to recover most quickly? And you can see this, and this is where history is transcendent to a certain extent. The same recovery rates, wealthy white people recovered first because they had insurance. They received the bulk of state and federal assistance. Poor black people did not. It was exactly the same with Hurricane Katrina. Okay, there's no real difference in those recovery rates. I don't have enough evidence to tell you what happened in 1867 in terms of recovery rates, but I bet you it's not too dissimilar. It's just too far in the past to have access to that kind of precision. But that's where the long term can be really felt. Not so much in the sensory experience, but in who gets to recover first and how fully.
And maybe sometimes it's even maybe two steps forward and one step forward and then two steps backwards afterwards. I don't know, but I thought about that when you also talked about how people gathered and, you know, prayed and all that in the both whites and blacks, and what effect this actually had to the Danish West Indies, which was also a racialized hierarchy.
Yeah, right. So all those differences are kind of suspended in the face of a natural disaster, right? But they're temporarily suspended. What you have is the reintroduction of those same inequalities after the effect, and they can be worse or they might be better, but they're nonetheless reintroduced. depending on who has access to the means of production, who has access to funding, authority, what have you. So there's a kind of social story here.
Thank you for your talk. It reminded me of Tarangambari, another former Danish colony in southern India, where I did field work a few years ago amongst fishermen. And the field work was on the remembrance of Danish colonialism, but of course this village had experienced a tsunami, and that was something that was, of course, taking up a lot of space in their minds, and often these interviews ended up being about the tsunami instead and the relatives they lost, and we often just ended crying, everybody. It was really a tragedy. But one of the things that came out there was, those of you who are familiar to the structure of Tarangambari, is that there was a fortress built by the Danes, which is still quite strong. And somehow the wave had hit in a way so that it became, because of the fortress when it hit, that became stronger, so that it was more intense in the fishermen village. So the part where the poorest part of the population lived was hit more severely. Also, of course, because of their structures is of less stronger quality. And so it was a kind of... remains of the colonial times that kind of hit in again. But I was just wondering if there was something like that going on there too. I mean, was there differences on how the wave hit, and did it affect different quarters differently?
That's a very good question. So kind of differential physical and social impact, right? The highest part of the wave hit Water Island, and apparently that was over 60 feet. If you don't live there, or people, not many people live there, it doesn't have the same impact, right? So I don't have that kind of specific evidence if one particular set of buildings was more damaged than another. It seemed to be fairly unanimous and indiscriminate in its destruction. Look, I mean, tsunamis happen all the time. They're just very small and you don't know about them. And if there's nobody there to be hit, then they really don't register as a historical event. These happen at a time when enough people are going to be devastated by it. But I can't tell you if certain buildings survive and other ones don't. I mean, 3,000 yards inland at 16 feet deep, probably not much is going to withstand that kind of damage. And as I said, stone buildings are gradually replaced with wood buildings because they seem to withstand, or at least absorb, the shock of earthquakes more efficiently. So there's a change in the built environment. What that means for the long term, I don't really know. But it's just like today, right? I mean, when hurricanes hit, they have to hit a population, otherwise they don't have a resonance. And that's why there's a fairly sophisticated tsunami warning in the Virgin Islands, because it's very populated now. And if it does hit, if there is a big one, it's going to cause even more damage. Apparently, when I was there, I was talking to a chap who knows much more about this than I do. But he told me that it's the second deepest trench in any ocean between St. Croix and St. Thomas, second only to the Mariana Trench. And what you really have is a cliff, a massive cliff. And the earthquake triggers an underwater landslide, and the displacement of the water, of the land, generates the tsunami. It's especially vicious because you don't have time to run. There's only 12 miles. The only advantage is that the wave doesn't have chance to gain even greater height in such a short distance. But if you hear that siren go off, it would be a good idea to run, because you don't have but 30 seconds to move. It comes in very fast and very high. So I'd love to know more about the built environment and what the differential impact, but we just don't have those records. And I'm shameless in my reliance on Professor Watlington, who has been fabulous with us. He's been very helpful. He produced kind of the documentary book on the tsunami. But I'm trying to get to how people experience it. And that's why I rely on the senses, because it's not just a visual event. is something that is a fully sensory experience and rearranges people's understanding of the world. And it's a humbling experience because their customary coordinates of understanding the world are utterly rearranged.
Mark, thanks a lot for that great presentation. It gets better every time I see it. I love it. And I really enjoy our conversations regarding the senses and history and bringing these stories to life. I think, in hearing you discuss this topic and then your work with Camille, I think one very important event in the Virgin Islands that would be fascinating for you to conduct a similar historical treatment of would be Hurricane Hugo, which, I came to the Virgin Islands in, 2012. And, the effects of Hugo and the echoes of that event still were continuing to that day. And so anyway, just a comment,
I think it's a terrific, I certainly got that feeling when I was there. I'm not from South Carolina, but I live there. People in South Carolina think that Hugo hit only them. It came barreling into Charleston and focused on us, and we were the people who experienced this Category 4 hurricane. They don't realize that the U.S. Virgin Islands were hit by a Category 5 hurricane. And it was far more devastating. And the people I spoke to had a similar sensory experience, right, who had lived through it. They suffered from the absence of fresh water for a while, access to food. Their clothes were wet, depending on the extent of the damage of the house, of course. The sounds of the hurricane are utterly unique, a soundscape you don't really want to inhabit, but you had to. Not so much about smell. It didn't really change the olfactory signature of the islands. But you're entirely right, Josh. These are the experiences that need to be recorded, because very quickly, Hugo is going out of memory. And 50 years from now, we're going to have to rely on talking to people who have an even dimmer memory of it, preferably not from South Carolina, in my estimation. But
I think there's one very insistent comment.
Yes. it's very interesting. Again, I have to echo Josh and say it's better every time.
And if coming from my poet, that's high praise indeed. So thank you.
As I think of Hugo, I live in St. Thomas, so Maryland was a bigger hurricane for us than Hugo.
Okay.
St. Croix got hit by Hugo much harder but Maryland hit St. Thomas much harder. And I was away during Hugo. And I have to say that the sensory discussion did not happen for me because I was away. And all I remember for Hugo was being on the phone with my mom and then the phone getting cut. It just went dead. So there were no sounds, there were no tastes, there were no senses. There was listening to the Weather Channel saying, it's 40 miles east of Puerto Rico. And I'm like, the Virgin Islands, that's the Virgin Islands. And no mention of the Virgin Islands on the national news.
Mm-hmm.
So the lack of that sensory experience was, to me, worse than actually experiencing Maryland. Because I knew where we were. I understood what I was feeling, hearing, touching, smelling. But being in the States during Hugo and not having that experience and not knowing, I think was worse. So although Maryland has stayed with me, and the fact that we didn't have light for 3 months and all of that, because of the type of people we are, very resilient, and it became something that we could function within. But being away and not being able to hear from them was worse to me.
So that's very interesting you say that, because the next stage of this project is to talk about how people who weren't there in 1867, what vocabulary they used to describe the events. And essentially, because they're not there and they don't have that experience, they rely on first-hand accounts. And that vocabulary migrates into diplomatic discourse. So bear in mind, when this thing hits, it's hitting at 2:50 p.m., okay? And they're supposed to sign this treaty of transfer at 3 p.m., 10 minutes. They don't. And they don't because they're reading these reports from American naval officers, and folks in the Senate and Congress start to talk about this event in sensory terms, and my argument is that they fundamentally become fearful of going further with this purchase because it's so unpredictable. Do we want a territory that has tsunamis, earthquakes that cannot be seen? We exercise a certain control over the environment, but this reminds them that this is a dangerous endeavor. And so I think, and I need to show this, I think that Seward et al., who have just bought Alaska, which is hardly, you know, a stable place itself, but there's no tsunami when they buy it, they infuse their diplomatic correspondence and their justification from withdrawing from the purchase in this sensory way. But they experience it vicariously, right? And I will say one thing, though. I bet the most frightening moment when you were trying to engage with what was happening was when the phone went silent. Right. So it's the absence of sound. That's the sensory experience of it, right? Which has to be absolutely chilling.
So that was another good closing remark, I think.
We're going to end on the word chilling. I love it, right?
That's very Danish. But, anyway, so thank you so much.
You're welcome.